You're listening to Eat, Play, Sex with Dr. Kat, the place to uplevel that sexy life of yours with expert talk on sex, love, and nutrition.
Just describing to us a moment ago about how being in more of this sympathetic system in fight or flight mode versus parasympathetic. So if we're in a state of I'm not enough, as or even in that workaholic mode, which is fast pace, right? And having to be in fight or flight mode for survival. Like, how did you see that impacting your body, or how do you see this impacting your client's body, your patient's body?
Yeah. And I've become the doctor that I am today because of my own journey. So it was definitely like a selfish journey, right? I really wanted to figure out what was going on with myself. And so that's why I dove into all the research. And that's why I stress to all of you that find somebody who's already done it, because it'll take some of the pressure off of you. But I needed to, like, that was definitely like why I was on this planet, was to just like go in deep into this category. And so for me, it was like uncovering all of these things that I could then help people with. What was the original question? I'm actually not realizing that I went
through tangent. I love tangents. That's flow. recognizing how being in fight or flight mode or versus being in parasympathetic mode, how is that impacting our body, our digestion? Because I noticed, I guess I'll speak to, I noticed when I started on that journey, even breathing before I would eat, like I would sit down in front of my plate and I would take some deep breaths, I would still feel the flutter of nervousness, almost like my body was still trying to go as fast as it typically.
Yeah. And this is like, this is foundational. So this is like a ground zero of gut health, is getting into a state where your body's ready to accept food. And that has to be the case. So if you just got into a fight, if you are doing like even something exciting, like crazy business exploration, or, you know, you just rode downhill mountain bikes and you've got all this adrenaline rushing, to really realize, like, are you in the state to eat yet? Or are you still in this survival excitement phase? And the importance behind that is your body will start to produce digestive enzymes, stomach acid, all of these things to prep you for the food when it's ready to receive it. So my kind of rule of thumb is if you're not salivating, you're not ready to eat. And so if you're not in that state where you're like, oh yeah, like I smell the food, I can like see it cooking, I can hear it, I'm excited, I've got like, you know, saliva increasing production in my mouth, and you're in a state of parasympathetic rest and digest where you are breathing, you know, your heart's not racing, that's when you want to receive food. And until you're there, then I tell people, like, do some mindfulness, like go for a walk, you know, lay down, put your hand over your heart and your stomach and just do a body scan. Like, are you ready yet? And the more we can start to train that, the quicker that we can get into that state. You know, it's kind of like the stress resilience where we can switch from one to the other, and the nervous system is flexible. And so it's really important, because if you're not, if you're still in that survival state, you're not producing the digestive enzymes, you're not producing saliva at a higher rate, you're not producing enough stomach acid to break down your food. And so it's no wonder that we're left after eating feeling bloated, gassy, like full stomach, like, you know, we've all had like that brick in the stomach where it's like, whoa, why aren't things moving? It's just sitting there. It's been 2 hours and I feel like I just ate. And that's because we're not ready and we're still trying to go, go, go. And our body hasn't switched into that more restful, digestive part of the nervous system.
And what a culture we've created around this. You know, we're sitting in front of Netflix watching like the most action-packed movies that are causing anxiety in our bodies while we're eating or racing to the next thing, eating in our car. So it's getting foundational, is getting present, because it impacts the way that we're digesting.
Yeah. And it comes back to evolution and like ancestral biology. So if you look at like what we were evolved to do, we're evolved to eat as a tribe, like in circles around a fire. And what that means is that conversations are actually good for digestion, because they slow us down so that we're not just shoveling in food by ourselves. But the conversation should also be ideally like supportive and happy versus an argument, which is not what's meant to happen around the fire circle. But conversational, like actually having a social moment that slows us down, that makes us really present. If you look at the blue zones where people are more likely to live 100 or older around the globe, socialization during eating is extremely common. You know, you see people gathering in groups to have meals, and the meals are a lot longer than they are here in the US, where we're, you know, going through a drive-through and picking something up and it's gone before the time we're home.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a really good point. And one, as I've been moving through again, another cycle of taking care of my body and slowing down and taking care of my gut, I put this to Instagram and I was like, okay, so I'm being a little more quiet on Instagram because I'm just, you know, stepping away from all that to just take care and be present. And I got, swear to God, I got a flood of like everyone and their mom and their grandma giving me the advice or telling me that they are experiencing IBS or candida or SIBO or, you know, like this whole number of different things, and everybody telling me that that's what it is, or it's parasites, or this. And it made me even more stressed out because I was like, oh my God, I'm not doing enough, or I'm not, you know, what do I do? What direction do I go? It's really overwhelming. So for anybody out there who's reading a million articles or listening to a million podcasts, where would you direct them to go? Start with mindful eating and then what?
Yeah. And then so my ideal would be, you know, go to work with a doctor one-on-one, naturopathic, functional medicine, somebody in the integrative world. If you've already seen your conventional doctor and it's not like easily explained, you know, exactly.
And then everybody like, okay, says so IBS, what?
Right. There's an in-between though too. So if you're not able to work with a practitioner one-on-one in the beginning, you can also start with an elimination diet, which is what I usually will put people on before when we're waiting for labs to come back. And that's really going back to a whole foods diet, but there's a few other things that you want to do with gut health complaints specifically. So we're going to take out gluten, we're going to take out dairy, we're going to take out eggs, we're going to take out corn, grains, legumes, nuts as well as a big one for people with IBS, constipation, bloating specifically. Mm-hmm. And they're healthy, so are eggs, so we want to put them back in, but we're going to take them out initially. We'll take out nightshades as well. So the question, the heck am I eating that? You're eating like lean, clean proteins. So wild caught fish, you know, pasture-raised chicken, grass fed beef as well. And then vegetable wise, we really want to cook vegetables. So like sauteed, mushy, pureed, treat your stomach like a baby. And so, you know, you would never feed a baby raw lettuce. So we're going to get rid of raw vegetables for a little bit and instead doing like sweet potato puree, or broccoli puree or broccoli soup, you know, things like that. And so we really want to baby our stomach for a little bit and focus on soups, stews, mushy foods. And then we're going to do that for 30 days at least and see how we feel. Symptoms are resolved. Great. Then you're going to start to reintroduce the foods, especially the ones that are the most nutritious that we ideally want in a balanced diet. So, you know, making sure we put back eggs in if we can do okay with eggs and do it really methodically. So you're waiting 3 days between introducing new food groups to see, is this a problem for me or nope, this isn't a problem for me. I'm fine with it. And you'll see like, okay, I can do this, but when I put back in corn, like I had issues. And so you may only end up eliminating one food group. And then I always reinforce to people, try 3 months later to put that one in too and see if you can. So it's not that everybody needs to be gluten-free for the rest of their life. Mm-hmm. But you might want a little period, like a little hiatus where you fix it, you repair things, and then you can reintroduce it later. So that's really, I think, like a really great place to start. And then the other like tips are doing a 12-hour overnight fast where you're giving your body a rest from food and trying to avoid snacking so much in between meals. So you're really having rest from intaking food. Food intake is essential. Like we get our nutrients from it, but it's also a little bit of a stress on the body, especially if there's any inflammation in the GI tract. So sticking to 3 meals per day and having that 12-hour overnight fast can be really, really helpful. So that's where I go with people. And then if you're still having issues after that elimination diet, go see somebody. Like, don't try to fix this on your own. It's going to be faster. It's going to be likely more financially feasible because you're not going to try a million supplements. So that's really where I suggest, like, if you've tried these couple things, then ask somebody for help.
Isn't that funny? We spend hundreds of dollars on supplements instead of going to a doctor.
Yeah.
That was the most detailed elimination diet I've ever heard. I'm not even kidding. I've spoken to, I've interviewed, and people give me the basics, but the way that you just described that was so good. I'm like, oh, okay, that is a point. I haven't made baby food for myself. Maybe I'll try that next. Yeah.
Lovers, thank you again for tuning in. If you enjoyed the show, hit subscribe and head over to eatplaysex.com to connect with me and grab my sexy guides. Because my goal here is to get you to eat, play, and sex better so you can improve your sex life, which will improve every aspect of your life. Until next time, keep it sexy.